We've talked before about your interest in genomic evolution and that the manner in which organisms change over time. And I'd like you to talk a little bit about that now, and if you could specifically talk a little bit about the challenge of understanding conservation versus mutation.
I have to start my response to this question. They're somewhat tired, aphorism of the famous geneticist Theodosius Dobzhansky. Nothing in biology makes sense except in light of evolution.
Okay.
This is oft repeated, but remains nevertheless completely valid and essential. All genomes that exist on our planet result from billions and millions of years of evolution. It's entirely impossible to understand how they work without taking this into account. To put it very simply, when we compare genomes of either closely related or distantly related organisms, we delineate conserved and less conserved variable parts. And what we can see is that the highly conserved parts are involved in functions that are essential for the organism's survival. Conversely, the parts that are variable contain genes that are involved in interactions between organisms and in interactions between organisms and the environment. Mm-hmm. For instance, we have been talking about viruses. For instance, the numerous genes involved in defense against viruses and other pathogens. These are also important genes, but they are not important all the time. They become important only when the organism is assaulted by the particular pathogen. And therefore, they evolve much faster, and they are locked in what is often called arms race between hosts and parasites. Even if we are not excited about the fundamental interest of the evolutionary process, for purely practical reasons, to understand what is important in genomes, which parts, which parts are involved in highly conserved functions that are common to a great variety of organisms, and which are involved in specific ones in the process of adaptation that occurs in front of us. We must perform evolutionary genomic analysis on a scale that is most appropriate for a given task.
So when you speak about conserved, this is not only sections of the gene that appear over generations of the organism, but also that appear commonly across groups of organisms.
To put a bit of a perspective onto this importance or essentiality of the evolutionary thinking for understanding life, it's useful to note that by now it's a firmly established plain fact that all cellular organisms, I'm not talking about viruses, all
Which
cellular organisms that exist on this planet originate from a single common ancestor, so-called LUCA, last universal cellular ancestor that existed about 4 billion years ago, just a little bit less, maybe. This was probably the most brilliant hypothesis in the history of science proposed by none other than Charles Darwin. But at the time, it appeared a wild speculation. But now it is a plainly established fact. So, the entire history of life, the unimaginably long history of life on our planet, spanning about 4 billion years, is permeated by persisting evolutionary relationships. There is, to be even a little more specific, there is about 100 of genes that are shared by all cellular organisms, from mammals to plants to amoeba to bacteria. Of course, the higher we go in the evolutionary tree, the more, the larger are the sets of conserved genes. See, different bacteria, the huge variety of existing bacteria, may share altogether about, say, 500 genes, with a few exceptions. Whereas, let us say, all animals share several thousand genes, 7,000 or 8,000 genes. Whereas if we, for instance, look at, let's say, humans and mice, hope it cannot be offensive in any sense, but these organisms share the great majority of their genes, about 80%, which may amount to something like about 20,000. What we call homologous genes, genes that come from a common ancestor that existed in the genome of, let us say, our ancestors with mice, they usually retain the same functions. This is more complicated in the sense that in the course of evolution, what often happens is so-called duplication of genes, when two copies are formed. And then they diverge and acquire somewhat different functions. So when we look at two related sequences, we have to be careful about inferring the exact same function, but nevertheless, there is always some type of functional relationship.
Do they ever revert?
Revert
or recover early function?
This is an interesting question. For somewhat complicated statistical reasons, this is highly unlikely.
Okay.
But this is not to say it never, ever happened. But this is really not a major route of evolution. In order to understand why, this is where a little theory is actually required. But it's extremely unlikely to go back.